Hi. Today's South Dakota adventure takes us to Wounded Knee on the Pine Ridge Indian Reservation. Here in 1890, nearly 300 Sioux were murdered in the last armed conflict with the United States government. Back in 1868, following the treaty signed at Fort Laramie, all of the land in South Dakota west of the Missouri River made up the Great Sioux Reservation. To control the reservation, tribal agencies were established. Now, usually an army officer or a civilian agent was appointed to be in charge. But often these men were dishonest and stole money and supplies for their own gain. A new program called the Peace Policy was instituted under President Ulysses S. Grant. Beginning April 10, 1869, all Indians were put on reservations as quickly as possible. This program was suggested by a religious group called the Quakers. From then on, Christian religious leaders would be appointed to run the reservations. It was hoped they would at least be honest and that they would educate the Indians and train them to be good citizens. In Dakota Territory, five agencies were assigned to the Episcopal Church: Yankton, Crow Creek, Cheyenne, Red Cloud, and Spotted Tail. Episcopal missionaries were already at Yankton and Lower Brule when Bishop William Hobart Hare became the bishop to the Sioux. Bishop Hare came to Dakota in 1873 with his headquarters at Greenwood at the Yankton Agency. The Sioux and Flandreau Indians were assigned to the American Board of Commissioners for Foreign Missions, which supported both Congregational and Presbyterian missionaries. Stephen Return Riggs and Thomas Williamson translated the Bible into the Dakota language. Up to this point, the Dakota Indians did not have a written language. Both the American Board and the Episcopal Church had missions at Santee, Nebraska for the Santee Dakota Indians who had been expelled from Minnesota after the 1862 uprising. Paul Mazakut, whose name meant iron shooter, was a Santee and the first Dakota Indian to become a minister. He was ordained a deacon of the Episcopal Church in 1868. The Standing Rock was the only Dakota agency to be assigned to the Roman Catholics. Most of their formal organized work with other tribes came after the Protestant missions were established. But Father Pierre Jean de Smith had visited the Dakotas as early as 1839. For more than 30 years, Black Robe, as the Indians called him, ranged widely through the territory. Bishop Martin Marty, the first Catholic bishop, came to Dakota in 1877. The churches played a major role in administering and educating the reservation Indians under President Ulysses S. Grant, but by 1880, the churches were no longer in control. In the years that they did have control, the missionaries served as a buffer between the white world and the Indians. They converted the Indians to Christianity and tried to teach them to live like white people. When an Indian man became a Christian, his family usually did too. But all of the old traditional ways had to be given up. A man had to cut his hair. If he had more than one wife, he had to send one away and her children with her. All had to wear the clothing of the whites, although the adults refused to wear the hard leather shoes. Each individual Indian's name was changed to a white Christian name. Indian children were taken away from their parents and put in boarding schools. The missionaries did, however, permit the use of the native language in school and worship. Prayer books, hymnals, and the Bible were written in Dakota. The Presbyterians published the Iyapaha, and the Episcopalians the Anpao. They were newspapers, both printed in Dakota. The native language continued to live. The churches developed Indian leadership by ordaining men as ministers. One chief, Tipi Sapa, of the Yanktons, became an Episcopalian priest, Philip Deloria. The Indians had been a religious people before they had ever heard about Christianity. Their religion was a part of every aspect of their life and could not be separated. They believed in a creator, and so the Christian God was not hard for them to understand. But it was confusing to be required to worship in so many different ways, as a Presbyterian, an Episcopalian, or a Roman Catholic. By 1889, when the permanent reservations were designated, a majority of the Dakota Indians were Christians, and many were devout. The new religion became as meaningful in their lives as the old one had been. But many had converted only because the food was given first to the Christians. In 1889, South Dakota became a state. The Great Sioux Reservation was broken up into smaller reservations: Standing Rock, Cheyenne River, Crow Creek, Pine Ridge, and Rosebud. Sisseton, Yankton, and Lower Brule had been established earlier by separate treaties. Land not included in the new reservations between the White and Cheyenne Rivers was opened to homesteaders in 1890. Thousands of white settlers actually raced into the former Indian land to stake their claims. The Indians resented the loss of their land. Saddened and bitter with the loss of their old way of life, they were forced to become farmers on the poorest land in the state. Now a drought descended on the new state, hurting even the experienced white farmers. But the inexperienced Indian farmers suffered even more on this poor land. In good years, the Indian farms had only been a supplement to the government rations. In the drought, all of the crops failed. The government did not increase the rations, and the Indians were starving. In Nevada, a Paiute Indian named Wovoka had a vision of an Indian Messiah coming to save all Indians. South Dakota Indians sent a delegation headed by Short Bull to learn of this new religion based on the Christian ideals of hope and love. What they would learn was the ghost dance. The version of the religion that Short Bull and others brought back to South Dakota offered hope to the unhappy, starving people. If they would do the ghost dance, the good life would return. The white men would disappear. The buffalo would return. And dead relatives would come back to life. If they wore a calico shirt, the white man's bullets could not kill them. At no time did this new religion speak of killing white people. The promise of the return of a good life would be fulfilled by dancing. But some of the missionaries were afraid that their teachings would be undone by this new religion. White settlers became frightened as the Indians gathered in large numbers to dance. At Pine Ridge, a new, young, and inexperienced agent, Dr. Daniel Royer, believed the Indians were going on the warpath, and he called in the army. At Standing Rock, it was rumored that Sitting Bull was involved in the ghost dance and would use it to promote an uprising. Agent James McLaughlin decided to take the precaution of taking Sitting Bull into custody, just in case the rumor was true. On December 15, 1890, 43 Indian police, headed by Lieutenant Bullhead, were sent to arrest Sitting Bull at his cabin on the Standing Rock Reservation. Some of Sitting Bull's followers resisted his arrest by the reservation police, and in the scuffle that followed, Sitting Bull was killed. It's said that at the crack of the gunshot, Sitting Bull's trained horse, given to him by Buffalo Bill, sat down and raised one hoof, as he'd been trained to do. The news of Sitting Bull's death spread quickly to the other reservations. The ghost dancers were frightened, believing that if Sitting Bull was killed because of the dance, they most surely would be killed too. So a small band of Minneconjou dancers, led by Chief Bigfoot, fled to the Badlands. They were going to Pine Ridge to surrender to the 7th Cavalry, but the army thought they were going to join Short Bull's dancers. Bigfoot and his people were overtaken in the Badlands and escorted to Wounded Knee Creek. The Indians set up camp and were surrounded by the troopers and guarded by Hotchkiss guns. On the morning of December 29, 1890, the Indians gave up their weapons. The troopers then searched each Indian and gathered every sharp-pointed instrument that might be used as a weapon. Suddenly, a shot was fired. No one could say who fired the first shot. But whatever happened, it set off a murderous barrage from the Hotchkiss guns. And when the smoke cleared, no exact figure of the dead Indians was ever determined, but from 200 to 300 were killed. The 7th Cavalry lost one officer and 29 enlisted men, killed in their own crossfire. The Indian survivors were taken to Pine Ridge and put in a small Episcopal church which served as a hospital. The white newspapers called the tragedy a victory because the 7th Cavalry had avenged the death of General Custer and his troops at Little Bighorn. To the Indians, it was a massacre. The ghost dance died with the people at Wounded Knee. The tragedy became symbolic of the plight of the Indian people for generations. It was a sad beginning for our new state of South Dakota. But this sad beginning did not leave the Indian people without their heroes. In the 1912 Olympics, an Indian athlete from Oklahoma named Jim Thorpe won several gold medals. And during World War II, on the island of Iwo Jima, when 5 Marines raised a flag to claim victory for the United States, Indian Ira Hayes was one of the soldiers raising the flag. In South Dakota, the Pine Ridge and Rosebud reservations have provided their share of important contributions to America. From Parmalee on the Rosebud, South Dakota's 2nd District Congressman from 1961 to 1971 was Congressman Ben Riefel. And from right here on the ridge, another Olympic gold medal winner, Billy Mills. Mills was a long-distance runner in the 1964 Olympics. So there have been heroes, and there have been conflicts. The American Indian Movement occupied this area in 1973 when 2,500 members came here to Wounded Knee to protest unfair treatment and the broken promises of the Treaty of 1868. So today, Sioux leaders are still working in various ways to preserve their rich heritage.